So, hello everyone. My name is Lakshman Prasad. I'm sorry for the cold I have today. I'm on more than the normal dosage for cold and cough this morning. So, in case I act something weird, you know why that is. So I earlier co-founded a company called HasGeek, doing web development consulting using Python and Django family of Highcharts. In my current role, I work at McKinsey as a software architect. I work in a team and work with consultants in order to deliver technology solutions to our clients. I have never really worked in the front end at all. The most front end that I did until recently was working with Django admin. Who knows Django admin? Okay, Django admin, basically the front end is, you don't write the front end, it provides the front end for you. So you say what the forms, you know, what fields in the database do you want, and then it provides a UI for you with all of those. So I got started with AngularJS just a few months ago. In fact, I wanted to work on it, get the application up. I was not able to, so for an entire day. I know how some of you might be feeling if you're still beginning AngularJS. The initial steep learning curve is very hard to come by. I got frustrated the entire day without being able to develop something. And then I started reading the book by Sham and Brad, and then, in fact, in a cafe not too far away from here. I've been drinking the Angular Kool-Aid ever since, and then I hope to be able to share some of that with you today. So today we're going to discuss an approach for rendering charts with AngularJS and Highcharts library. Think about it again. I think maybe the talk title may be slightly misleading, because although we go through the directives of the Highcharts themselves, we want to go through it in a perspective and objective of being able to develop Angular directives in a good way. Not necessarily to create good charting libraries, which you can, of course, do. So the way we learn Angular directives is by using some of these Highcharts directives, by building it, by discussing aloud, where do you want to put different components. I would like it to be an interactive session. I want a lot of feedback from you. So I recently developed an application with hundreds of charts, and this is the approach that I used. In fact, I'm planning to put it all together in the form of various different directives and open source. But even if I take some time in order to do that, and if you are doing it meanwhile, by following the approach that I am going to discuss today, or we're going to come up with today, you can use it in your applications today as well. So I want to leave you with something interesting in case you don't find this talk interesting. I built an application along with all of those directives, which is to visualize Sachin Tendulkar's career stats. You can check it out on Jump Sachin ST. You will be able to see the application. If you find that interesting, by all means, go ahead. Even if this talk is quite interesting, it's being recorded and you can watch it later. Server-side charts, we all know, right? I mean, charting is a pretty common thing. It's not something new. Of course, we have some fancy ones today, but charting has been a possibility since a long time. I did a talk at Fifth Elephant recently where I showed off creating, analyzing the data from users this in order to find out what is the most popular headphone used by someone, what is the most popular keyboard, what is the most popular hardware, software, etc. And when we analyzed those data from using this, I generated that graph pretty quickly. It's not really hard at all. That's pretty much all it took in order to create a chart, in order to find out what is the most popular headphone, or most popular software in this case, or the keyboard for that matter. So you have a matrix, and then you plot with a kind equal to whether you want a bar, pi, or anything, and then you get the charts already. Right, so server-side charts are a possibility, and they are pretty easy, no big deal about it. That's pretty good enough for publishing. I published findings from that one using exactly those graphs on Medium. It got front-paged on Hacker News, and then there was tens of thousands of people reading it, and then there was pretty good feedback. There was charts, and then I was able to publish it. if you are a magazine company, then these static charts are good enough, right? The only one downside about these server-side charts normally that comes is that they look Excel circa 2007 rather than JavaScript circa 2013, which is, I think, a valid objective. But in order to counter this one, there are very good themes. This person, Cam Davidson-Pylon, has a very good course in which he creates his own, the course is on probability and statistics. In order to display excellent graphs, he has his own themes for matplotlibs. And then you can see these graphs definitely do not look like Excel Circa 2007, which is a complaint. So you can generate pretty good graphs even using the server side by using the necessary themes. So that's not really a bad, you know, not really a downside of a server side charting itself. You would all like to think like that, right? Have you seen any of the D3 visualizations, particularly by Mike Postdocs and New York Times? They're really mind-blowing. The charting is into the next level. You don't see a chart with the bars or pies anymore. You want to pull, drag, based on the size of this one, and then move this one around into whether this state goes to Republic or Democratic, and then there are two PNGs of Obama and Romney. And depending upon how much you put there, this starts smiling a little more. This is the graphic of 2013. Check out all the Mike Postdocs D3 charts. They're really mind-blowing. I find it to be extremely interesting. So anybody with any charting library, with server side or the front end, obviously we'll have to stop for a second and have a look at it thoroughly, because this is how the charting is going to be. So, similarly, so what is it about those D3 charts that really make us feel really good about it, that it stands out with other charting libraries? Basically, the ability in order to interact with it. I want to be able to see the graph I want to see. So people normally say, when Sachin Tendulkar scores a century, then the percentage of India wins, people won't find out this answer. So that's not good enough, right? I mean, that is just one graph. I want to be able to find out when Sachin scored a century in Mumbai against Australia, what is the percentage of India wins. You can't publish all of these graphs. It would take an entire magazine and you'll never be able to go through that. So you need an interactivity. You need to be able to choose the data that you want to see. In fact, this is one of the graphs. In the Sachin statistics there, you can go to find out yourself, where you choose a particular score and you see how many times Sachin scored below that and how many times Sachin scored above that. And of that, how many matches India won and how many matches India lost to both of these donors. And why is score 100 so relevant? It's an arbitrary score, right? You can move the slider around in order to vary anywhere between 0 and 248, which is 248, 200, whatever, is top score. So how do we do that? How do we do these kinds of interactive charts using Angular and Highcharts? Do we know about, so today we are going to be using the Highcharts charting library in order to render these charts. Anybody knows about Highcharts? Used Highcharts earlier? Yeah. So Highcharts basically builds upon jQuery and renders SVG. I don't really care about the implementation anymore, because the thing that I need about it, excellent API, reasonably good performance, and then being able to work on all of the devices, all of these paths. So Highcharts charting library basically does all of these for us. And then it has all kinds of charts, like 100 plus of them. You want a, you know, basic bar chart, area chart, column chart, pie chart, donut chart, scatter plot. You're all covered. I want to stress a little bit more about the API, because that is what makes me bring that today into the discussion in order to discuss Angular Directives. The API is very, very simple. In order to create a new high chart, basically you say a particular container.highchart and then pass a set of JSON options to it. What kind of chart, what is the title, what is the x-axis, what is the y-axis, all of these are JavaScript objects themselves or JSON objects. Most notably, between the various different graphs, obviously the title and all of those change, but if you want to just talk about the data, there are two things, which is the categories, which is what you want to plot, and then B, the series, which is the data that you want to plot. These are the two things that has to be dynamically fitted into this. So Angular is very good in pointing. We know that, right? Already we had two different sessions. You put something into a, you change something on a view, and then it automatically gets reflected back in the controller, and then you change something in the controller that gets reflected back in the view, automatic. And if you, one of the, if you have seen any Angular example at all of them start with one basic example. Okay, let's have an input and let's display that. And then you type anything into the input, suddenly this thing keeps changing. You seen that? Yeah, does it ring a bell? Yeah, exactly. So basically Angular is extremely good in binding. In order to develop these kinds of interactive charts, what I'm talking about is being able to develop these buttons where you click these and the chart updates itself. Angular is good for binding, Highchart is good for rendering, so we use these two in order to develop interactive charts if we need. Sounds good? So, we already know a lot about Angular thanks to Sham's session and another session before this. But I want to stress one important point that Angular brings to the table other than what JavaScript used to be. So, I have spoken to several of my friends who are extremely good developers, and most of them wanted to avoid working on the front end because front end normally felt like, you know, doing hacks. It's like you want to make something work, you try this, you try that, CSS web transform, and then opacity, and you try 10 different things, and one of them happens to work, yay. But backend is so not like that, you can literally engineer. This API comes in, you want to do that, you can write tests. What I think Angular brings to the table, which probably is true for several other frameworks as well, is brings the engineering back into the table. Using Angular, you can do tests the way you did in the backend. Using Angular, you don't have to bother about how do you pass things from control into the view because it's automatically done. All right, so now you know what are all the things you know so far. You know Highcharts API, which is basically you provided JSON and then it gives you the charts. Yes, you know that Angular is extremely good in binding, so you display a set of options as and when those change, options inside the controller changes. Yes, and then we know that interactive charts occurred, so we're going to develop it. So let's say, if you were to develop a high chart using this one, if you want to develop high charts, how would you do it? Go ahead, anybody? Sharp cannot answer because...
So you capture the values in some scope object and then
right.
You should do a service, get your JSON and fill up the categories and so on.
Sounds good. Let's start with... So I'll start with step minus one, which is not even using Angular. How would you do it using jQuery? If you were to do it using jQuery, basically you have a container element and you say, within this container, give me high charts, these are my various different options, correct? So this is not good enough, right? I mean, if we have to change everything, so we want to do this all over again and again, we don't want to do that, we want to do better. So step zero is something that he mentioned. Let's come to the Angular. So we have a controller there, similar to the HTML, we have an HTML like earlier, except it also has a controller, we call it the chart controller. And for this controller, we have the jQuery again. This is something Sham mentioned earlier, which is basically you put your jQuery inside your controller. It's not really good. But at least it gets the Angular part of it. It gets the controller. So it's called step zero. It's like Angular. What's the step one? How can we better it? Can we do better? Yes? So what can we do better?
Directives.
Yes. So we learned earlier already what two things. One, we don't manipulate the DOM inside of a controller. Yes? Where do we manipulate the DOM? Yes. We manipulate the DOM in the directive, and then where do we set the scope variables? In the controller. So how can we change it such that we put the DOM manipulation into the directive and we take the scope setting into the controller? How do we do it? So we call it step one. So this is the char directive. So the HTML remains the same. In this case, it started with the directive. So directive has so many different options. We can't cover that, but I assume quite a few of you are already quite comfortable with these options. you set a, so instead of having a div element with the container, I replace it with a chart directive right now, which is like a HTML element. And then I say in the directive, I have a template which has a class. And what is a directive? Directive is two things. The HTML that has to go, and B, the JavaScript that has to affect on it. So it is both what it displays and what is the behavior it has. So what is the behavior it has? We will go into the link function. So the directive basically is a restrict E in order to say this has to be given in the HTML as an element, not as an attribute or as a class. It has to be an element and it has to have a certain template and it has to go with a certain behavior. In the behavior, I take the first element that I'm providing in the template and then rendering Highcharts within that. Good? So what do we do in the controller now? Anybody? What is remaining? So we set the data. So what does the directive do here? The directive does not necessarily automatically watch the scope variable. The controller does, not even the controller does. Basically the view renders automatically and the changes in the view go back to the controller. In the directive, in order to be able to watch for the chart ID, I put a watch on that. You see that, I see on the scope I watch chart ID. Whenever the changes, I create a new Highchart object and then render the chart output. Another way of rendering Highchart is to create Highchart or chart object. That's about it. You don't have to call digest. So I'm taking the Highchart option that is there in the scope and then creating a Highchart object. There's no need of digest. Digest automatically handled. Inside the controller, basically I set all of the options that I need. Sounds good? For the Highcharts. This is a good step one in order to do a Angular Highchart Angular interactive directive, yes? So, can we do better? Can we do better than this? Anybody?
What about destruction?
Sorry?
What about the destruction of the Highcharts?
So, there are two ways. One of them, the chart ID gets replaced, therefore the new Highchart comes up automatically. And B, if a controller goes out of the scope and another controller comes, automatically gone out of memory.
What about the custom events created by Highcharts?
I think since the controller goes out of scope, those also get erased out of memory, but I'm not sure about whether it eliminates all of these from the memory or not. I'll have to probably look. I think it does. There's no reason why it would not. So, what can we do better though? So, do you see all of these chart options that I have written within the controller? Is this really the best place for it to go? What can we do? Where can we put that? Great, excellent, exactly. That's the next thing. So, we put all of these inside a service and then call, I want a spline chart with margin, with so much animation, with legend, etc. And this service is injected into the controller and then I set the element after getting a Ajax call of my particular data. Sounds good? Why would we want to put this in service? I would assume you are not having exactly one chart but so many different charts. And you don't set the options for the font, for the title and all of those within the CSS. Because this is SVG, you have to set it on these options. So if you put it inside a service, then since this is a JavaScript object, you can extend each other and only manipulate and modify the thing that you find relevant for this particular chart to render. And you import this, you inject this one in your controller, and then you use the specific, you know, thing you created for specific JavaScript object you created for a particular chart, and then you set the chart ID, and the Highchart automatically renders from the directory. Sounds good? This is good enough. This is good enough to one extent where you have amazing charts. So this is Sachin Tendulkar's progress through his career. In 1990, he started with this is multiple y-axis, which Highcharts provide automatically. And then the green color line is the average. The left side y-axis represents the aggregate runs, and the right side y-axis represents the actual runs. So you can see he has maintained a consistent average. And obviously, the high score is going to be step by step. Once he scores a high score, then it keeps increasing as and when goes around. This is already good enough in order to render basic Highcharts. But we set out with us saying that, you know, basic, simple Highcharts by displaying that, we could probably do that using a PNG, using a server side. What's the point of our front end? What do we need? we need to add interactivity. Yes? How do we add interactivity? How do you want to say, let's say you want to display, I don't know, maybe only runs in that, or only the aggregate runs, or only this one, or different kind of interactivity, or you want to see test and ODI. Yeah, that's an option here. Actually, in the right side, okay. This particular chat hasn't got it yet because I haven't had the time to scrape the test data yet. So, basically, if you want to do that ODI and test interactivity, how would you do that? Anybody? Exactly, yeah, of course. You have checkboxes that is in the view, which is mapped to a particular model. And this model, you have to watch initially, let's say we watch it on a controller. Sounds good? So we are watching a particular model, and when this model changes, we call the plot option, everything that we did earlier in a controller, I put it into a function called as plot data or plot chart or whatever. And then when these options change based on ODI or test, I call the plot options with that corresponding attribute for rendering the test data, the ODI data. Sounds good? So that's what basically this is doing here. You extend, basically I'm watching the chosen option, the option being test or the ODI data, and then I call the plot data whenever the chosen option changes, and I call the http.get in order to get the JSON from the server, or it could even be my own server, which is a local file in this case. That does not matter, so HTTP is already good enough to handle it, and then I set the scope.chosen options.view is equal to ODI or test, ignore the trends, I could do that. And then, whenever the plot data, so this, I think the step 3, whatever the option is there, is closing the name of the function, that is the plot data function basically. It creates a new JSON object based upon my default options as well as the current options and then renders the chart. Once this is set on the scope, then what happens? Highchart automatically, directly automatically picks up and then enter the chart for me. Sounds good? So this is how to do the options. How would you do a interactive chart? Basically set a radio button when something changes. You call the plot data with the corresponding attribute that you want to save. You're good to go. So I think this is a little, since we're talking about Highcharts, a good time in order to take a little bit more digression about Highcharts itself, how it works, and what are the other options we can add into the directive. So if you say new Highchart, what it basically does is destroys all the SVG elements that are present right now, and then creates a new SVG element and creates the whole thing all over again. It's okay. I mean, if it's on a web, you hardly notice. In fact, sometimes you prefer that because of the animation. But if you have a chart very similar to Sachin's lifetime score and you are on a mobile device, then in order to compute all of these, a render is going to take a few seconds. You're not happy at all. So you don't have to re-render the whole thing. Highcharts has its own API in order to only manipulate the data. And when you only manipulate the data, it instantly updates. So you could potentially use that option. And that's not good enough, right? Instantly updates and not seeing anything. Charting is all about how beautiful you make it look. We need animation. So in order to animate it, what do? You add all of the new set data elements one by one to it. Actually, I'm not sure if Sachin chart has any good animation. Okay, there is an animation. In the carrier summary chart, if you're viewing it, if you change the bottom things, the pie chart expands and contracts very slowly within that. That is the animation. So you increase the value slowly one by one every 200 milliseconds. That is when you achieve an animation. This is a good time in order to say whether we need an animation, whether we want an instant update, or we want the chart to render all over again. Why would we want the chart to render all over again? In case you're changing the title, you're changing the options, etc. This does not really affect that. So this is a good time for us in order to say, maybe I will put an option on the chart directive where I say draw equal to animate. And how do you refer to that one within the directive? So you have a link function. The link function would take, I haven't included the actual link function here, but the link function would take attributes as an option. You refer to the attributes on, and then you look for the draw. And if that is there, as animate, then you animate, otherwise you update, making one of them the default. Sounds good? So, again, this is also not good enough, right? Can we do better? Only ODI and test, I'm not happy. I want to see, like the first summary chart, you can see runs, centuries, you can see in country versus country. You need multi-level JSONs. Let's say I have my multi-level JSON, which is, you have revenue, this is for an airline application, let's say. You have for all flights, you have for different months, you have for 2013, you have 2014, the 2000 difference. How would you do it? So you have JSON that is listed structure, and then, so first I think you are in agreement that in order to do an interactive chart, rather than having so many different JSON, particularly if there is a API call, let's club all of them into one JSON hierarchically so you can refer to the particular JSON. Are we good with that? Are you in agreement with that? Because it says API calls for me, only one API call and get all of the data, and on change of this radio button, instead of referring to various JSONs, I refer to an element inside the specific JSON. Sounds good? So, how would you do that? So, if you have to refer to a multiple JSON element, just like how we had a chosen option earlier, you have chosen options where it is not going to be just an array, but it's going to be an array of arrays. You refer to chosen option of 0, chosen option of 1, etc. Sounds good? So, that way you can have a multi-level JSON structure and be able to see the relevant graph by choosing the option within your controller by using the Highchart directive. Can we do better? So, this will be one complicated chart directive that we end up in the end, which I will also put up in a GitHub repository you can refer to. Can we do better than that? Anything we can do? We have the chart as a directive, but so far what are we doing? We're putting the options themselves directly in the HTML page, right? Can we do better than that? You make these options themselves also as directives. So we have an option whether you want to choose revenue, in this case whether you want to choose revenue, specific month, or you want to choose the specific year, etc. So many different levels, 4 or 5 levels. Actually, I have built charts with 6 nested levels using this technique, using the same directive, and it works extremely well. So, one of the things you can do, not to make it even better, is not just make the chart as a directive, even the options that go on the HTML as a directive. So, this is exactly where the Angular option of directives communicating to each other comes in. You should probably refer to this one. You have a parent directive that has a controller which has all of these options populated automatically, and the child directive, which you say requires this directive, can access the attributes that are present on the parent controller. For example, we have a form and then we have an input. An input does not make any sense without a form, yes? So an input knows that a form exists and then therefore does a lot of validations based on the form validation requirements, yes? Similarly, we can have a child directive which is in order to present a set of tabs or a drop-down or a set of drop-downs by looking up the parent directives controller, because all of the things are populated in that. So where are we getting with this? We have a highly interactive chart, the first chart that you see in the search and stats application, where you have 3 levels. You can choose ODI or test, you can choose in country, how many versus country and home, and you can see whether you want to see matches, runs, average, centuries, any of these. So, how many charts is this? How many charts is this? This is not one chart, okay? This is actually one chart, one JSON API. But as a user, for me, if I want to see this, how many charts is this? 7? Yeah, 4 into 3 into 2, 24. Am I right? So, ODI and test is one option. And then in-country versus country and home are 3 options. And then you want to see how many runs he scored, how many matches he played, what is his average, and what are his centuries. These are the 4. So they all multiply. And then you have 24 different charts using one JSON and then one Highchart rendering. This is how one of the ways you build a Highchart directive using Angular directives and then Highcharts, interactive charts. So what did we build so far? What does it take now in order to build a chart like such a local interactive chart? We have built one directive that already populates options. We have built one child directive that reads the parent directive controllers options in order to render the options. And then we have a chart directive which looks into, which is being watched in the directive itself on the scope, and whenever it changes, the HCharts automatically populates. So now, knowing we have built all of this, in order to develop a chart like Sachin Tendulkar, a summary chart which has 24 different levels, what does it take? We basically have an interactive chart, we like to call it as interactive chart, or it's basically options. I don't see the point why it should be called interactive chart, but that's irrelevant to this discussion. So we say we have an interactive chart. The directive itself can take the URL rather than you taking it in the controller and then populating it, because the directive has the controller now, which takes the data and then populates it. And then you can even say it is a pie chart because you have developed pie charts within the services. We already put the Highchart options in your service earlier. And then let's leave the override now. But basically, if you have multiple pie charts, you need different options. You need something to override for this pie chart. So the best place to define that would be on this charts controller. Do you agree? I have a pie chart. I take a pie chart and render it. Then it renders exactly the same thing if I have a pie chart in two different places. So I need to make specific changes to the Highchart that I render in this view. Where is the good place to do that? That is the controller of this particular pie chart. Yes? So, what is the method, what is the object that is defined on this particular controller which has to override everything? So, if you put all of these, you say the URL, you say the options, and you say the override, there's one more thing I need to provide which I probably missed here, which is to say how many levels is this JSON. So, in this case it is 3 because ODI, test, and then runs, matches, etc. You say that, and then you provide level options wherever you want to do that. Level options, level equal to 1 on the top right, level equal to 2 in the above the chart, level equal to 3 below the chart. And then you provide the chart. That's all it takes in order to build an interactive chart by building these components. Sounds good?
But how do you place these different options in the UI?
So that's the level options directly we built, right?
Yeah, but you have associate CSS with it.
So in this case, I am using ng bootstrap, which provides me an option in order to provide a set of buttons as a readable set of options. So the level options directive, instead of giving all of these as radio buttons, gives out a directive that ng bootstrap knows. So that will be rendered, and that's why I'm using the type also. Not necessarily all of the place you need buttons. You need buttons some places, drop down some places, radio some places, you see the type equal to that. So, in order to develop an interactive chart, basically what you say is, okay, get this data from this URL, this is 3 levels deep, level 1 options put here, level 2 options put here as a drop down, level 3 options put here. Can it be any simpler than that? So, this is one of the charts, so basically, which shows that the level 1 is in the form of a button. Level 2 and 3 is in the form of a drop-down, and then level 3 is in the form of a slider in order to see which week that this belongs to, and it displays 2014 data to 2013 data and the difference between those data. And another important point to note about this particular gap, although we haven't really dived into that discussion, is what if the JSON is not exactly symmetric? So when you say multiple level JSON, you assume that similar kind of keys exist in all of these JSON, so you can do that. So, in this case, basically the answer to that is you sniff the JSON dynamically within the directive instead of actually assuming or defining the values either on the directive or on the controller. You sniff the JSON dynamically in order to find out what various options are, and these options vary themselves. This particular chart also does that, sniffing the JSON and then automatically updating the various level options. Yeah, so does this remind you of anything? To me, it reminds me of the image tag. You say, here's the image, here's the source, go get it and display it. Somebody who wrote the browser wrote some way in order to do all of this happen. And using Angular directives, you wrote your interactive chart, which is primarily like, here's the URL, go get it and give me a chart. You can add as many options you like to that, or as little options you want to add in order to keep it simple. So, any questions?
Probably a broader question of
So, yeah, I think the question you are referring to is, if you see all of these have URLs also on these. Here, in this case, the URL ends at summary. But in case you want the in-country versus country home, etc. to be a part of the URL, then you can define route specific to that. And then when you have route specific to that, you can share. In fact, I was very specific, very keen in order to build a chart, you know, create chart that you can share. You see the Facebook, Twitter, and then share buttons there. So, Highchart basically itself also has an exporting option, which exports the current image that is existing. So, you click on this on your mobile device, or this is not, the app is not yet there, but once it is there, or on the web. You call the Highcharts exporting library in order to give you the current JSON. That is the kind of sharing that I used in this project. But I agree. One of the, if you want to use, if you want others to be able to see exactly the same chart without considering them as radio buttons, which basically sees the state, you can do it as a part of URL using routes. The prompt, yeah.
So Google Maps manages this something similarly. So when you ask for the link, it gives you the link with the exact code.
Right.
So that's one thing which probably you can implement, in which you pass all these data and all these.
Yeah, I think that's much more interesting data. So because the way I have created the directives, if I try to create routes, then it really messes with the way I'm working all around right now. Instead of passing the routes, maybe I can pass these as options. And when it comes to this route and the get parameters, I give to this chart. That may be a better option. Sounds good?
So I'm totally new to Angular. I realized that you completely defined the new element called chart.
Right.
Which you created with how simple image tag is. So there was probably a time when that was not a good idea to define your own tag.
Right.
Be your own element. So is that now valid HTML or HTML5 or how does it go?
Absolutely. I think if you look at the future of HTML5, the way it is going, one of the most important things that they are coming up is web components. Web components is like these components. It's not a web component. It's an Angular component, I would say. Angular directive is an Angular component. A web component is basically somebody builds something like this. The implementation is different. So basically, and then shares it. You can use it in your project as a web component. So this is absolutely the right way to go about it. I don't see any problem using this. In fact, Sharp can answer more about it.
I can just jump in here. One thing is, if you're using new element directives, just be careful about IE7, IE8, if you need to support it, don't do this. Otherwise, you'll have to do document or create element to tell IE that this is actually valid HTML. If you don't need to support IE, this is beautiful.
In which case, you end up using a dev and given an IE.
Yeah. So yes. And then you use attributes.
Yeah. The way I would answer that is, don't support IE and go ahead using it. So in summary, so like we discussed earlier, Angular brings engineering into the front end the right way. The interactivity that Angular brings, and then Highcharts provides the charting. They go very well together. There are other charting libraries, D3, and I think the next session is about one of the D3 charts. So where he discusses about, it's a little messy because D3 has its own binding, Angular has its binding. So how do you remove D3 to not have its binding and use Angular binding? So you need to figure out a lot of things out. Probably a good session for that one we could do. But if you are using something that does not have binding, just provides charts, it goes extremely well with Angular. Yeah, so if you are using any form of charting, please provide interactivity, choosing, filtering on the front end, because I don't want to see a newspaper published charts on a particular app. I want to be able to see and create my charts out of it. I don't want to see that when Sachin scored a century, what is the percentage of times India won versus India lost? I want to see when Sachin scored a century in Mumbai against Australia, what is the percentage of times India won and India lost? Yeah, we haven't really spoken too much about backend, but it's probably a little trivial in order, because all we are caring about in this case is just a JSON coming to me somehow. You could add a backend in the form of if I were to use a backend, I use Django REST framework, which is amazing, provides a lot of features in order to refer to the database and provide it. But this particular application that I worked on actually used Rails API, which is a stripped down version of Rails, in order to provide the JSON, which is also very good now. Here, you know, some Flask people were to use it, I'm sure they will use Flask RESTful. And then there is Seneca, which is basically a Node.js, very thin wrapper on top of Postgres and Redis only, which can pull out the necessary JSON and give to you. Use any backend you want. As long as you provide the JSON, this thing works. Yeah, building your applications using Angular is absolutely at least an order of magnitude better than not building an application using Angular. This is what I learned. It is definitely much more than that for chatting specifically. Yeah, so because all of this is the front end, only thing we refer to from the server is a JSON. Nothing stops us from bundling all of these resources together and then putting it in an app. So all your big data insights will be available to you on your phone. Very beautifully at that. Yeah, with all of these, it's absolutely a joy to work with Angular. I think I should thank Sham, Brad, and Misko, and all the 600 other contributors for their 7,000 or so pull requests. So in order to make it a joy for me to use Angular, that's what I've got. Thank you. Yeah, so if you have anything to talk about, talk to me, please feel free to contact me. Yeah, I think you can already Google for it. It's on both SlideShare as well as on Speaker Deck. Any more questions? So, with respect to the performance, with respect to using Highcharts, I think the most important question there comes is the performance of the library we are using, which is Highcharts, which is reasonably good. I have developed an application with hundreds of charts, and then the performance test I've done is actually browse the application. And it's absolutely very fast. I haven't seen any issues. Therefore, it hasn't necessitated me in order to dive deeper into any performance issues. I will probably die if there is an issue, but there's no issue so far. It's a good question. I think it's a very good question. There are several ways to do testing of charting libraries. One way would be you create a chart, you take an image out of it using the exporting thing, and then what you know is right, you save it in your database. And when you run the test next time, you provide the same data and using the API, and then do the diff of the PNG. If they match, you're good. But I think that is not necessary. What are you ending up testing anyway? Are you testing how Highcharts enter the charts? That's the job of Highcharts people in order to test. I wouldn't want to test that. What I want to test is, given this API to you, do you provide the same series thing that I provide to the Highchart? Which is easy. I mean, you can document an input JSON and then what the output JSON is, and then if you want to run tests, you say you pass this and then you verify this against what was in your database, as long as they are same, if you have the exact same JSON, then you're good to go. I'm not sure I follow the question. So as long as you verify, when you view this data to the chart, this PNG is provided, this output in the form of series data is product which you attach to the chart. If you have validated this already, irrespective of what user logged in and then different kinds of data that is passed, I would assume appropriate chart would be rendered to the front end, right?
Okay. So only if you want why series from you is just an image comparison between these two and you want to compare
So, if you want to go really full length, you should probably verify the image. I wouldn't do an image test. I think it's going a little too far. I would only do the testing of a method which takes the API input data and provides me the series data which I pass to the Highchart. Because anything more than that, if you're testing Highchart's library, I don't want to do that. Unless Highchart's in my library, or I have written a library in Java test. Anything else? All right, sounds good. Thank you.